Hello everyone, welcome to another episode of World 1-1 Podcast, where three unlikely friends get together just to talk video games and shit. Joining me, as always, is the amazing, the one and only, Eddie B.
Come back to me, I'm begging you please, come back to me, baby. Hey, everybody.
With a voice like that, why do we need any other music interest?
But it's like, why are you single?
Yeah, exactly, eh? Well, he says he's single, but I'm pretty sure everyone at that church is just melting for that voice.
We could discuss that later. But continue.
Joining us, of course, as well, is Papa Bear himself, the best beer out there, Larry Giver.
What up? We need to talk about Adrian's intro, though, because Adrian doesn't get to introduce himself tonight.
Nope, apparently I don't, and I'm going to regret this, but please, Larry, just go ahead.
And of course, we have to introduce our host, the Minister of Maple, the luxuriousing Latino, the Caramel Connexion.
Oh, damn
the
it.
The Butterscotch Broheim.
Oh, darn.
Adrian!
This already went to hell. Hello, everyone. What's going on?
Eddie says there's no do-over button.
I know. This is just it's going to be out there, like always. Anyway, thank you, everyone, for joining us again. Thank you guys so much for coming. I don't host often, but today I came up with a very specific topic that I wanted to talk to everyone.
So before you get into your topic, I'm hosting. Adrian, but before you get to your topic, everybody, what? We have our developer, Mr. Adrian Nieto. His game, Tuna Cycle, has been released on iOS and Google Play. Give it up. Yay!
Thank you. Thank you very much. Yes, Tuna Cycle is finally out, the game that I've been working for the past, I don't know, like 5 months or so. It's finally out there on Google Play and the App Store. It's fantastic. The reception has been great. A lot of people have been loving it, so I'm very happy about that.
We got to know. When do you find out first week sales numbers?
I'm not sure. Both stores are kind of weird. They're not releasing like that kind of data just yet. I'm guessing we have to wait like a week or something, so we'll probably know by Wednesday night or something like that. Either way, I've been kind of running the numbers by myself of people that have been, you know, interacting with me and whatnot. And you know what? The numbers, I think they're close to the 100. At least that's my math. So that makes me happy. 100 people that are playing the game out there. That's fantastic. So yeah, if you're listening to this, just go ahead and play it. It's totally free to get. It has like little ads. Or you can just pay $1. You get the ad-free version, and it's just really cool. A lot of people have been sharing their online high scores online, which is like really great. I'm nowhere near the person that has the highest score, which I think was 500 the last time I checked. That's really cool. So yeah, just go ahead and play it.
Yay.
But back to tonight's topic, though.
Important reminder: remember, it is only $1.
It is only one dollar
instead of the cheeseburger that Eddie bought last week.
That's true. That's true.
I got a meal, so I spent $4 and some cents.
Yeah. See, why put garbage in your body
then?
Yeah. Why put garbage in your body when you can install garbage on your phone? But anyway, today's topic is something that I've been looking at a lot lately. So as an indie developer, of course, I follow a lot of other indie developers, and I play a lot of indie games. Of course, they're probably my favorites. So I just wanted to talk about indie game characters appearing as guests on other indie games. Like what do we think, which characters, cameos we like in some other games, which cameos we would like to see ahead. But before we start, I'm just going to read a quick list that I compiled here quickly. of indie games that have guest appearance of other characters. So first of all, we have Dust and Elysian Tale, where you can find and rescue Meat Boy from Super Meat Boy, and yeah, he was there, man, and Tim from Braid. So you have those two characters there. Minecraft is known for having a bunch of packs. They're not really considered guest appearance, but either way, it kind of fits the description there. Super Meat Boy, you can also unlock some other indie characters in the newer versions. Rumbo, the entire cast is basically a big indie character party.
Can we call it an indie gangbang?
Please don't. No, we're not going to call it like that.
An indie orgy?
Nope. Not doing that.
It's at least got to be an indie orgy. Someone pay homage to the wonderful people that gave us permission to use their song for our show.
Fine. Just because of that, I'll let it go. Continuing with the list, we also have BitTrip. Which version of BitTrip, Larry?
I want to say both Runner. I might be thinking Runner too, but I know that Fate had a fuck ton of them. They had a bunch of indie characters that were all like little power-ups.
Okay, cool. Yeah, there's another one. Azure Striker Gumball 2 is going to have a stage where if you scan your Shovel Knight amiibo, you can actually fight Shovel Knight, which I thought it was really cool. I mean, he looks fantastic in the game instead of the 8-bit model that we're used to seeing Shovel Knight on. He's like a full, I want to say like 32-bit sprite kind of. So he looks really cool. And he has voices. For the first time, he just like, and stuff like that when he is attacking. So that's really cool. Wakamele also has some indie appearance from, I want to say, Castle Crushers characters, if I'm not mistaken. And looking through Steam, I also found two other indie games. One is called Team Indie. It's like a 2D platformer in which you use different indie characters and their unique abilities to traverse the world. And I thought that was really cool. And one that I just discovered, Super Indie Cards, which is like a Super Mario Kart type game with indie characters. And it has a bunch of really different cameos. So I thought that was really cool. Did I miss any that you guys know that I don't?
Yes. I know an incestuous one. Which I know one? A couple, actually. Castle Crashers had the alien from Alien Hominid. And the Battle Block Theater had both the Alien and it had the Castle Crashers and Battle Block Theater.
Even though all three games are made from that same company.
That's why I said it's incestuous.
Yeah, it kind of is. But it's fine, though, right? Like, they're different properties and they're like, kind of like mixing and match. We may see Luis and Luis on the first machine game, so who knows? Anything can happen in the world of indie games. But this is just a small list. I'm pretty sure there is tons more. If you know of any that we missed, just write us an email to world11podcast@gmail.com, if I'm not mistaken.
Correct.
All right, there you are. So let's just go around the table. Which of these guest appearances, which ones have we liked the most? Eddie, why don't you go first?
Oh, goodness. I would probably say Rumbo because since it's like a 9-player game and there's a lot of options for a lot of indie games, that one gives you more variety to play with. So I think that one is like probably the coolest one. I want to say BitTrip also, but the games and the music of BitTrip is just better than the special guests in itself. So I'm just going to go with Rumbo.
Cool. Okay, what about you, Larry?
Personally, I got really giddy about seeing the alien in Castle Crashers the first time I played through Castle Crashers. That made me super happy because I loved Alien Hominid. I was playing it earlier today, actually. My wife was, the hell is this? This looks awesome, and I've never seen you play it. And she got all excited seeing it. But, yeah, I totally got jazzed over seeing the alien in Castle Crashers.
Yeah, I remember. I mean, Castle Crushers is just a fantastic game. It's probably one of the first ones that launched the entire indie movement back in the day.
As much as I like BitTrip, I can't say I was crazy about the the indie nods in there, only for the fact that most of them I'm looking at going, I know it's a character from another game, but who the fuck is that? Because there was a bunch of them, I'm just like, I know it's from something else, but I don't know what it's from. So I felt a little lost on that one, but...
Yeah, I think that's why I like, and I am going to go with Eddie on this. I think my favorite guest appearance has to be on Rumbo, just because all, like, first of all, Rumbo is a Wii U exclusive game, although it is coming to 3DS as well. But
3DS specifically, if I remember correctly.
Yeah. No, it's Wii U only right now, but it's coming out on 3DS.
Right, but when it hits 3DS, it's only coming to new 3DS, though.
Oh, yes, you're right. Yeah, my bad. So, I mean, because I'm a big Nintendo fan, we all are here. That's why we're here, really. All those nindies, that's how they call them, I know, like, all of them. I know all their games. I play all of them, most of them, if not all of them, really. So when I was playing Rumbo, I mean, I unlocked Shovel Knight, and that was it. That was my guy. I always play as Shovel Knight. But I was playing with Bobby Pauls, who runs the Nintendo Guru YouTube channel. And he likes playing as... Oh, man, I'm going to hate myself for messing this up. He likes to play as one character. I forgot which one is it. Alejandro Costa from the NBC group as well. He plays as Tostada from Guacamelee. And, like, everybody uses a different... Basically, like a different indie character from a different game. There is Shantae. There is what's this? The little guy from Tesla Grad. I totally forgot his name right now.
I know who you're talking about.
Yeah, well, that dude, that little kid. There is Juan from Guacamelee as well. There is Rusty from. Oh, I'm forgetting his game now. SteamWorld Dick. Sorry. My bad.
SteamWorld's so good.
Oh, it's so good. I just love that game so much.
I haven't got the new one, the latest one that came out, but I got SteamWorld Dig on my 3DS, and oh, that game is just amazing.
I love that game so much, man. That was that game was recommended to me by an instructor back in college, and it was kind of the game that got me back into playing my 3DS a lot more often. He was like, you should totally play this game. I tried it out for like 5 minutes on his 3DS. Got super hooked, and I was like, you know what? I'm going to go right now to EB Games. I'm going to buy a $20 Nintendo eShop card, and I'm going to download this game tonight because it looks really cool. And that's all I play for like a week, really. Just SteamWorld Dig all the time.
Still play the hell out of that. That's like a default I'm bored game.
It is a really good and board game. That's a good point. I wish they released a physical version of that game though. Like I will probably buy it on 3DS again if it had a physical release.
They probably made just like much, a digital. Yeah, they probably made too much money already for doing it digital. So they probably be like, well, people already might have it, so a physical copy wouldn't make sense to them.
Yeah, I know, and it makes sense, right? But you know, a guy can dream, I guess. Those are our favorite indie guest appearance there. If you have any, of course, you can email us as well. Let us know which ones you like overall. I'm pretty sure Rumbo is one of the most popular ones out there, though.
Mm-hmm.
So let's
still need to get on Rumbo.
You totally should. We tried, well... The guys play all the time, but I try to join every Wednesday. I probably join like every other Wednesday, and we play for like 2 hours or so. It's fantastic.
I'm kind of holding out for the physical copy that's coming, though.
Oh, that's fair. Yeah.
The space on my Wii U is limited, to say the least, at this point, and I would rather just hold out and be able to have a physical copy anyways.
Yeah, no, I, oh. Yeah.
Yeah.
I agree on that. Yeah, you should totally wait. Although once it gets on new Nintendo 3DS, man, I'm gonna be playing it a lot. I'm gonna buy it and I'm gonna be playing on the bus all the time. It's just gonna be great, for sure.
I'll have to skip it because I don't have a lot of people around me that plays it here in my area. I would trust me, I would love to, but I just don't have anyone. I'm like, dang it.
Well, get it on Wii U and play with us online.
I know. I need to.
Okay. Anyway, moving on to next kind of like topic here is which like indie guest appearance would you guys like to see on a different indie game? I mean, a Sir Striker Gumball 2 having Shovel Knight as an amiibo feature, I think it's one of the greatest things I could have ever asked for. But do you guys have? It doesn't have to be an indie game either. It can be like a, you know, like a, just like a Nintendo game that has some of those characters. Which game would you guys like to see?
Ooh, I don't know. I kind of want to see Box Boy do a crossover with Tetris for some unknown reason. Just like
that would be amazing.
That or Puzzle Fighter, if Capcom ever brought that back. Like, I would love to see them do something like that.
Although, is Box Boy indie? I thought it was just a Nintendo game.
It's a Nintendo game, but it's like, it's indie in the fact that there's no physical.
It feels
copy.
Very indie.
Yeah. Like, there's no
physical. That's not what indie means, though.
Well, yeah, I mean, from an indie developer, that would be different. Like Zeo Drifter. Like, I would love to see Zeo Drifter and something like Axiom Verge. Like, you know.
Those are indie games.
Right.
Yes.
But I'm saying, like, Box Boy being something with Tetris, because Box Boy didn't really get a physical release, and it's not known for Nintendo to treat a game as indie. As Box Boy is, like, I think.
Yeah, no, you know what, I kind of agree. Like, Box Boy feels kind of indie on its own. I mean, it was like what, like $5 when right. It came out. It's a very small release, and then, yeah, like it has that indie charm.
I think their approach to developing it was fairly indie.
Yeah, I don't think the budget was too big either. So.
Yeah, it kind of had that feel like they wrangled up a couple people in the office, like. You, make this.
Yeah, make a game in 48 hours. Go.
Make a game.
Yeah, pretty much. Although, you know what? I kind of agree with that. Like, having, like, the Tetris blocks have that little QBBY, I think is his name, like, face on the Tetris blocks, I think that would be really cute. Like, each part of the Tetris block is just, like, a little face. I think that would be really, really funny. But what about you, Larry? Which game would you like to see some indie guest appearance?
Well, I threw it out last week with our Smash list, which we still need yours. I was a big proponent. I really wanted to see Commander Video in Smash Brothers.
I think it will fit well. I kind of
love
agree.
Commander Video.
Yeah.
I'm sad I never got one of the Commander Video t-shirts. It was just all black, and it had a white rectangle right
across. Yeah, in the middle, yeah.
Yeah, I wanted that shirt. Anyways, but no, that aside, oh, fuck. I had one rolling around in my head just a second ago, and it's now run away again. Damn it. Now, there's so much that they could do. Oh, hell.
I'll go while you keep thinking.
It'll come back to me.
Yeah, Smash or Mario Kart will be kind of like ideal places for me to see indie game characters at. However, I think on BitTrip, there could be some really cool like indie guest appearance, like Meat Boy. Meat Boy should be a character there. I mean, he's always running anyway. So why not make him a character?
For Smash?
I think he... No, on BitTrip.
Oh, for BitTrip.
Yeah, I mean, he's always running. I mean, Meat Boy is, so might as well just stamp it in there.
I'm gonna throw him. I hope they will make like a fire level, and you can just see his meat cooking. So you have to run real fast to get it out the like an oven or something or whatever the level is.
So yeah, I think he will be a cool fit there.
I can see that.
However, you know what? On Shantae, I believe, and you guys can correct me on this because my history with Shantae is very limited. Isn't there a Shantae game where she transforms into animals all the time?
I think so. I think it's the third game. The Shantae series, because she has so many of them. Because I think she does not have Jenny Hero. It's not Pirate's Curse. I think it's the second or third game in the Shantae series.
Okay. All right. Well, anyway, I think it would be really cool if she could like just transform into different indie characters. I mean, she's like a genie anyway, right? So maybe she can like summon the power of a bunch of different indie characters. Like, oh, I need to like dig my way down here, so I'm just gonna transform into Shovel Knight. Or hey, I need to jump really high, I'm gonna transform into Meat Boy. Hey, I need to like run this section really fast, I'm gonna transform into Captain Commander, right?
Right.
Yeah, there we go. I always forget his name. I need to punch a lot, I'm gonna transform into Juan from Guacamelee. You know what, like really cool stuff like that. I think Shantae will be the perfect place to put a bunch of indie game characters' appearances.
Oh, I remember the thing that was in my head.
All right, go.
I really, really want to see Clayman show up in Armacrog. Clayman needs to have a guest appearance. And it's entirely possible that he does, and I'm just not aware of it because I haven't played it yet. So I'm waiting for the Wii U version, but I know it's out on PC.
Clayman? Or which game is that?
Clayman was from The Neverhood, which The Neverhood at the time wasn't really, and still technically isn't, an indie game. But the guys that made that are the ones that are making Armacrog, and it's kind of turned into a little indie studio now by comparison. I'm calling Armacrog as an indie game, and I want to see Clayman in it because he was one of their creations.
Hmm. That was really cool. I remember that game now, and I think I remember Clayman too. We talked about this a little bit on a previous episode, didn't we?
Yes.
Yeah. I remember now. Yeah.
It had that glorious PlayStation sequel, Skull Monkeys.
Even though this is a weird crossover, the game Flower, if it crossed over with Pikmin, I would kind of see what shenanigans would get into that game. That or what is the Wind one that came out on Wii?
Which one?
What is that? Flower was a PlayStation indie game. But there was a there's a Wind game, a 2D Wind game that came out on Wii on
You're not thinking of Lost Winds, are you?
That's it. Yes, Lost Winds.
That game was awesome.
Lost Winds. Yeah, I don't think I ever played that. Although I did miss a lot on the Wii.
Check that out. That game was actually pretty fucking clever.
On WiiWare, yeah.
It was on WiiWare.
Yeah. It was on WiiWare.
Oh. Okay. Yeah. See, I missed the entire WiiWare part because, again, I didn't have a credit card when Wii was a thing. And I think, well, I don't think I can pick it on Wii U now. And I'll be damned the day that I go into Wii mode on my Wii U. I'll be damned.
It's worth it.
I hate that Wii mode. It's so slow. It's awful.
But you're in the game, there's no difference.
Nope. Nah. Just going into there, I just cringe.
Hey, it has more stable than mana. So
when we're playing the Metroid Prime series, although we were only playing Metroid Prime 1, I downloaded the trilogy on my Wii U, and every time it went into Wii mode, I was like, oh my god, I hate these things so much.
Yeah, and you were in that menu for about 60 seconds. So what?
No, that's a minute of my life that I'm never getting back. Time is money, friend. I can't handle it.
That's time and money well spent.
Exactly.
You really did miss some good stuff on WiiWare, man. It's worth going back and visiting.
Dude, like, I know it so much. I remember my first introduction to WiiWare, even though, like, I had a Wii for some time. I got a Wii on release. But my first introduction to WiiWare as a platform was when a friend of mine showed me, what's the game with the blobs?
I know what you're talking about.
World of Goo.
Ah!
Which one?
World of Goo.
Yes!
Yeah, that is a fantastic indie
game. Is amazing.
It's so darn good. So my friend was showing it to me on the Wii, of course. And I remember, man, like we play like a Christmas Eve for like hours upon hours just trying to get like the right way to solve some of the puzzles in that game. Because that game is hard, by the way. That game is really hard.
You have to know your physics. Like, you have to be creative with your designs to know your physics.
Yeah, oh man. But it's so, like, it's such a well-built game.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So we play a lot of that Christmas Eve. And, like, I just remember thinking, like, man, this is fantastic. And that was my introduction to the WiiWare as a platform. But then again, like, the Wii was, at least for me, I was kind of, like, being taken away a little bit from the Wii. I was kind of, like, getting bored of the graphics. I'm not that kind of guy, but I did get mad at the graphics on Wii. And that's when I moved to a PS3, so I was, you know, kind of done, sadly, with the Wii already. I've heard so many good stories about the WiiWare era that I would like just to go back and play some of those games.
Contra Rebirth was a return. Contra Rebirth was a return to the form of Contra. Like, it's difficult if you put it on just like normal, but it gets super challenging when you put it on the hardest setting, and that's what I like. Like, even though it was like $10 for 5 stages, it would kick your tail. And it had some of the craziest but coolest level design and bosses. Like, you're fighting, like, I think on a truck. And then it goes into you fighting, like, on ants and stuff. Like, it's very weird. It's such a cool, cool game. I love Contra Rebirth. That was the first game I actually got when I got for WiiWare. And I just enjoyed that game. I mean, come on, Konami. These are the games that you were known for. Why can you not bring that feeling back? Like, you know, people went crazy because Legend of the Mystical Ninja came out for Retro Console. For Wii U, and people are just like enjoying it.
Wait, what?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Legend of the Mystical Ninja came out on Wii U.
Yeah, it came out this Thursday.
Virtual Homes, you better turn your system on.
No, I'm just. Oh my freaking god, this is the only game this year that I've never played.
You need to play it! Oh, the Legend of Mystical Ninja is completely hilarious, but the platformer is so good. It's very Japanese in music and tone. I love it.
My favorite game I really can't say what my favorite game on the N64 era was, because there's so many good games.
Oh yes.
But one of the games that I had
favorite was Quest 64.
Oh yeah, of course. Who doesn't love a good old Quest 64? One of the games that I hold the dearest to my heart was Goemon's Great Adventure, which is, I want to say, the fourth game on this series?
I think so, yeah.
Because it was Legend of the Mystical Ninja. There was one on Game Boy, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yeah, exactly. And then there was the first one on N64, which I'm forgetting the name. And there was Goemon's Great Adventure, which was the last one. And man, like I just love that game so much that selling it was one of the worst mistakes I've ever done. But just when I first moved to Canada, I found a guy selling a copy, mint condition, for $50, and I snatched that from his hands and I play the crap out of it.
I love The Legend of Mystical Ninja. I played that when it came out on the Super Nintendo back in the day.
And, man, I can't believe it's on virtual console. I'm going to buy that tonight.
Yes, it is.
Just remember, Adrian, without WiiWare, we wouldn't have gotten Mega Man 9.
And that's true. And you know what? That's another game that I miss, and that I'm sad that I miss, really. Like, I miss so many cool stuff on that era, sadly.
So, Wii Mode is not so terrible.
It is very terrible. Oh, it is. God. Oh, man. You really love it, but I just really hate it.
I don't love it, but it doesn't bother me. It's functional for what it's supposed to do.
See, this is why you're a bigger man than I am.
Hey, I'm playing Skyward Sword, and I'm glad it's on. I could do that on Wii U. Now, if there's a Skyward Sword HD coming out, I'm going to the store like right away to buy it. I'm just letting you know that.
Yeah, it's probably not going to happen.
Nope.
I don't think that can translate to anything but the Wii.
I just want.
That'll have to,
I'm sorry,
that'll
everybody.
Have to
I just
support the entire controls, though.
I just want Breath of the Wild right now, like literally.
For the record, as I'm sitting here playing it at the moment, I just want to talk about the fact that Breath of the Wild totally aped the Rock character from Metroid Prime.
I seen that. I was, yeah.
Oh.
I saw it, I'm like, the fuck is Stardust doing in Zelda?
That's fair. I agree.
It's just worth
it. That fight.
I love the Stardust fight. I love the end of it, where the whole thing goes down. And Samus is walking away and gets hit in the back of the head with a rock and turns around. And you can't even see her face, but you just know she's like, really? Ass. Like, it's one of the few times you get any little bit of levity and humor in a Metroid game, and it was golden.
Oh, man, I'm just thinking of going to play Legend of the Mystical Ninja now. That's all I want to do.
So I do want to scratch that. I need to take a moment. We need to shout out and say hi because I've been made aware that there are several new people actually listening to our show.
Ooh.
So I know that our audience is growing, and I'm sure some of that has to do with the fact that I go, here's our page, check it out. And I'm actually hearing back from a couple of people going that they're listening. So shout out to the fine folks that have just joined us recently in the last week or so. So
that's fantastic. Hello, everyone. I hope you're enjoying my train wreck of a host.
No,
it's not going to happen again for a while. So that's totally cool.
I got the best compliment. A friend of mine was listening to the Future Racers episode, and I asked him, I said, so what do you think of the show? He goes, it's not bad, but the host is a twat.
That's fantastic.
I love my friends.
If you think any of the other hosts are twats, just email us at world11podcast@gmail.com.
I'm professional. I co-host this show and like four more other podcasts plus my own.
You can still be a twat and host a podcast.
I'm professional. I cannot be that. I have to be professional. I have to be able to keep things in order.
We are all a bunch of dicks, and you know it.
Hey,
and that's
my name.
I can't wait for you guys to see the Halloween mask that I ordered. It's actually a penis head.
My name is not Richard. I am Edward. That is my name.
I thought your middle name was Richard.
No, my middle name is Detective.
Ooh. That's not canon, but all right.
And once again,
do we have anything else to talk about the indie game guest appearance on other games? Any final thoughts?
Just keep them coming. Like, I love the indie community coming together to make decisions like that. And regardless if it's a business deal or not, it's good to see that people are aware of great indie games. And putting it in other great indie games and just building a friendship or a community or like a form of respect is going to keep players coming back to want to see more of that in other games. And that shows how much support that you actually have. So that's a good thing. So I hope a lot of indies keep doing crossovers. They're doing it more than third party and first party, but it would be like, you know, if you guys love these games and you love seeing they becoming your favorite characters and you see them in another game that you had, even if you've had no business, like no idea of or interest in that game, if you see your favorite character in it, I say go ahead and buy the game because it might surprise you that it's a really good game and having your favorite character in there, it just makes it better.
I think one indie thing that needs to happen, or at least happen more, is I need more awesome little indie amiibo figures.
Yeah,
I need some more.
Okay, let's talk about that for a second. Let's pick maybe three each. Three indie game characters that you will love to see as an amiibo. Okay, you started this topic, so just go ahead, Larry.
I'm going to start by saying I want Castle Crashers on my Wii U, and I want all the knights. I want the red and the orange and the blue and the green knight as amiibos, and then I want them to be able to drop into other games.
Would you like them to be separate amiibos, or just like one amiibo that has all of them stacked up together?
Oh, no. They need to be separate amiibos.
Okay.
And I think they need to be able to be used in like Shovel Knight, since they all have different powers.
Okay, cool. I like it. What about you, Eddie?
The Guacamelee. I would like the hero. I would like him to have an amiibo in the game. So when a server come out for Wii U, you could use him in the game. Like, I would like that. Shantae, I kind of want her and have her own amiibo to be used in the Shantae games. Last but not least, even though this is not indie, so please forgive me, everybody, I would like Phoenix Wright to have an amiibo.
That's not indie. That doesn't count.
No, that doesn't count, but I just wanted to say that. For third...
You know what? I think it's more probable for us to see a Professor Layton amiibo before we see a Phoenix Wright amiibo.
Oh, that is true. I would like to see Zeo Drifter or the nerd from Mutamux. I would like to see them have an amiibo because they're really good games.
I'm going to jump on that Seal Drifter. I love that game too much, so I would love to see an amiibo of the little guy.
One of the girls from Switch Time Force. Mighty Force, yeah.
Yeah, that's another good one, yeah. I have those games on my 3DS. You should probably play them. For me, I mean, top of my list will be Rusty from SteamWorld Dig. I would love to have an amiibo of him. I think he would really work at an amiibo. Mm-hmm. I think the guys making—I forgot the company name—but I think they were working on some sort of amiibo functionality on their latest game. So who knows? Like maybe we'll see Rusty.
Ooh,
that would be really cool. I would love to have one of him.
Excited about that.
Yeah, and you know what? Minecraft is very big. Give me a Steve amiibo. You know, put amiibo support on the Wii U version of Minecraft that I can, you know, just unlock like a very simple skin pack, just one, just to dress up my character. It doesn't have to be a full texture pack as the Mario series, but just like a regular dress of whatever, right? Like Shovel Knight or Rusty or Pete or whatever, right? Like any of the amiibo available, I think that would be really cool. So yeah, I think those are my picks. Did they have three?
No, you need one more.
Well, I didn't. I'm missing a couple here.
All right, go ahead. I'm gonna think another one.
I another one that I think really needs to come to a Nintendo platform, but it will never happen. I want Gomez from Fez.
Oh, that would be fantastic. Yeah.
Oh, that's my good God, pick. I love Gomez. Gomez is the bomb. And beyond that, I think I would totally dig a little Clayman amiibo.
Yeah.
He would be awesome.
Man, that it's just like I know Fez will never come to a Nintendo platform. I don't even think we'll see anything else from Fez ever again.
I think he's going to come back to game
development. That's one of the most heartbreaking E3s for me when, you know, they drop the announcement teaser, Fez 2, and then Phil's like, fuck this shit, I'm out.
Yeah.
Well, that was all because of the Twitter beef, so part of that was his fault and part of social media, so, you know.
Yeah, I'm not going to lie. Honestly, after watching Indie Game, the movie, which is still on Netflix, so if you guys haven't seen it, mm-hmm. or anybody listening hasn't seen it, go watch it.
Yes, please.
It's really good. Phil Fish reacted badly to a lot of what came flying at him, but a lot of what came flying at him was unnecessary, just asshattery, people being dicks for the sake of being dicks because they felt entitled to something. And frankly, I can't say I entirely blame him for telling them all to fuck off.
Yeah, I agree. Sadly, it is what it is.
The
Phil Fish should stop.
Can I add two more?
Jesus Christ, Eddie. Every time I tell you one and you give me like a list of 17 games. Sorry. Now I tell you three and you give me like seven games.
I'm a big game fanatic. All right,
I'll give you two more.
Okay. Hyper Drifter Lite, when it comes to Wii U, that game just looks amazing, and I hope it comes to Wii U. So, like, the main character, like, I kind of want to see him have an amiibo, like an 8-bit amiibo. And then, goodness, what was the other one I was just thinking? Oh, crap. I'm sorry, then just Hyper Drifter Lite. I forgot what the second one is. I was just thinking it.
That's fine. I don't think I have another character that I would like. Maybe a Meat Boy amiibo. I think that would be really cool. Meat Boy and Bandage Girl, maybe both of them together. Oh, that'd be amazing.
Oh, I got it. Even though it's not on Wii U, I hope it actually did come to Wii U or NX in the future. Bastion, the character from that.
Oh my gosh, I was playing Bastion today.
Yeah, I have it for I think I got it for PS4 and I was playing it. I would love to kind of see that come to Wii U or NX and have him have a amiibo.
You know what? If we're talking about games that we would love to see on a Nintendo platform and would love to see as an amiibo, I'm just going to drop one here, which is probably my second or third favorite indie game of all time, which is Ori and the Blind Forest. Give me Ori and the Blind Forest on Wii U or 3DS. Give it to me on the next.
I couldn't take it. If I see an Ori or even the Ma, just like the Ma from the beginning or Dad, whatever he is,
Nabu.
I see an amiibo right there, I'm going to cry because I'm just automatically going to buy it. Like, I could put my bank account into the negative if I have to, but I would have to have that.
That game made me, it threw me on a gaming blue depression for weeks. For weeks after I finished Ori and the Blind Forest, I had no idea what to do with my life. I don't think I fully finished the game that we're playing in the book club. I don't think I work very well. I was trying to find the next game to play, and I was getting bored of everything just because of how powerful Ori and the Blind Forest was for me.
I need to finish that game.
I am in love with that game. So those are my picks. Larry, do you have a final pick?
Let's see. What am I? Yes. Yes, I do.
All right.
I'm totally with Eddie. The kid from Bastion needs to happen, which, by the way, Eddie, I need to share with you when you come to visit next month.
Uh-huh.
That game looks fucking pretty as hell in 3D.
Really? I will expect it, yeah.
It looks so gorgeous in 3D. The colors just pop just beautifully. But that being said, I would totally dig the little UFO from Insanely Twisted Shadow Planet. Like, all the little fucking arms and contraptions sticking out of it at once, looking like a little Swiss Army UFO.
Oh, wow. I thought you was going to say a car from F-Zero that you could put in Fast Racing Neo.
No.
That would be cool, too, but no.
I don't think it would fit. It would have to be something from Wipeout to go in Fast Racing Neo, really.
Oh, I agree.
Oh, I couldn't handle myself. I would look at you. I would get on Skype with you, Larry, and you too, Adrian, and be like, y'all look at this. I'm about to just pass out on my bed, and I want y'all to be witness of it, and I'll just fall out.
That reminds me, by the way, we need to make a quick addendum to our Future Racers episode. It was pointed out to me, and I can't speak a whole lot to it because I made mention to the gentleman that I don't have any history with the game myself. But we did miss one, Connecticut, apparently.
And I've never heard of that.
Fucking remember Connecticut. I know I didn't play it, and I don't even remember it. But what apparently, I don't remember. But for the life of me, I have an inkling that it might have been a PS2.
Okay, I'll have to try to find it.
That's probably what I'm missing then.
So, but I just wanted to throw that addendum out that, yes, we missed one. There was one that I've not played, and I couldn't remember for the life of me because I don't remember it. So.
That's fine. And with that, I think we have reached the end of this World 1-1 episode.
No, we haven't.
Oh, why? What did we miss?
We're missing your list because you weren't here last week.
Oh, for Smash?
Yes.
I'll have to go back on that on the next episode, though. I don't have it with me, and it wasn't finished by the last time I was working on it. So.
All right, we're holding you to it.
Yeah, next week for sure, I'll ask me again. We'll probably start the show with that.
I do have a final question for you.
Yeah.
Tuna Cycle.
Yes.
Who is your favorite? Is it Louis or Louise?
Are you going to make me choose of my favorite child here live on a podcast?
Yes.
I'm putting you under the bus just like that.
Yeah. Oh, man. You know what? It's actually quite funny. When we were making the game.
Oh, dang it.
At the beginning, the characters were just like two triangles. They were just like balancing back and forth. So it wasn't very attached to the game at that stage. It was not until Alex, or a magnificent artist, started working on the models for each character that I just fell in love with Louise. That bow tie, those pearls, that lady tuna. She looks so freaking cute on everything she's doing. That's just how I play. I always play with her on my phone.
You heard it here first. Adrian has a tuna fetish.
Yeah, apparently I do.
Dear Nintendo, Microsoft, please bring Cuphead to the NX so I can get an amiibo for that. I'm sorry, Adrian. When you said her and the vision came in my head, amiibo version of Cuphead came to mind because they kind of same, not share the same graphic style, but have that old cartoon look, with the eyes and stuff. I just now thought of that. I'm just like, oh crap! Now I want Cuphead on NX with an amiibo on it.
They will really fit as an amiibo. That's for sure. Well, if we are good, then it's time to wrap it up. Thank you everyone for listening. Let's just go real quick around the table. Where can people find you, Eddie?
You can find me on SoundCloud, iTunes, and Google Play under Optional Opinion. You can listen to that podcast. Also, you'll be able to get the World 1-1 podcast. You can hear me on the Deluded Geeks podcast at the Anomalous Radio Network, .podbean.com, where you'll also get Optional Opinion. You can hear me on the DNA Power Block. That's Corey's Derek's podcast for the DNA community. You can hear me on DNA Dual Shot, DNA Nurse Gone Rogue, and also coming soon, DNA Kinetic Connected. You can hear that. You can follow me on Twitter at That Retro Code, @ThatRetroCode. Join us on the World 1-1 Facebook page where you will see our info for our Wii U's, our 3DS's, PlayStation Networks, our Xbox Live, so you can come and game with us and, you know, conversate with us what you guys want to hear from the show, discuss other video games or anything that you want to. You can email the show at world11podcast@world11podcast@gmail.com.
All right, my pasta just got burned after all that. What about you, Larry? Where can people find you?
I'm up on Facebook. Larry is always right, giver. New this past week, and links are up on our Facebook page. You can now find all of our past episodes out at archive.org/details/world1-1. We got that page put together, so not only can you now find all the old past episodes for anyone that's just recently jumped in, but they're all easily downloaded in a nice, convenient zip file in one go. So that's up there. We've got, I'll refresh the link to that as well when this episode goes up. So that's available. That's a thing that took some time, and I'm quite proud of the fact that we now have that. Beyond that, my Wii U and my 3DS codes are up on the Facebook page, and I will probably reshare that out again just to refresh that. I'm also up on Xbox Live at Megatron0016. Other than that, that's kind of it. I'm on other places, but you probably don't want to go there, so.
And also, and also, everybody, this past Monday, it's the celebration or the remembrance of Satoru Iwata.
No, we're not talking about it next week. We're not talking about this.
I know.
We are not. Eddie, we're not.
We'll talk about it next week.
Thank you, everyone, for listening to the show. We're not talking about such stuff right now. You can find me online at on Twitter or Instagram or pretty much anywhere on the net. Bajox, that's B-O-J-O-X-C, I guess, because it's American C, or set if you're Canadian like me. You can find the game that I worked on, Tuna Cycle, on the App Store and Google Play completely free, or you can buy it for $1. That's totally cool, too.
You can join the NBC Video Game Book Club on Facebook.
Man, I'm always forgetting everything that I'm on.
Next month, we're for some reason playing Tuna Cycle.
Yeah, exactly. We're playing Tuna Cycle for some reason. It has nothing to do with the fact that I run the group. No, we're playing Paper Mario right now. Actually, you know what? That's a good reminder that tomorrow the new poll is going to go up. So join there and, you know, vote for which console would you like to play next. And, you know, just join a bunch of really cool people playing some really cool games. And I think with that, we are out.
Nope. Bye. Last thing. I need to congratulate everybody on the show tonight. We went the whole show without fucking talking about Pokemon Go.
There we go. Hey! Yay. No Pokemon Go here. Especially because the servers are always down and you can buy my game, which was a worldwide release, and it doesn't disconnect all the time. And now, with that, we're out.
Bye, everybody. Bye.